Good evening. I pray that everyone has had a restful and good day. To those online, I see you already logged in, so God bless you and thank you for being there. And for those who are here in person, looks like we're getting back to our sunlight days, and so that's good. And we have plenty of time in instruction. We're also going to be adding a component in just a few weeks, so that you'll be able to go while we're doing Bible study, put your headphones on, and walk around the park and get your exercise at the same time. You don't have to be in here sitting down looking at me. I'm going to stay over here. Some days I might go out there. I don't know. I may walk and teach. Who knows? We want to add those components as the sunlight comes back, really just to be a more diverse and thriving church. Speaking of a diverse and thriving church, let's talk about the church from resurrection to Pentecost. So this is the period of time that we're in now. Is Easter over? All right, what are we in now? Eastertide, right. Okay, so a lot of times, and this is something I was just talking to one of our members about, how sometimes in particular areas of our faith, we have isolated and left out the broadness of instruction that can sometimes be helpful to the greatest number of people. So we've journeyed, and in a very non-traditional manner, I like to continue in this process and in this manner. We are a very non-traditional church in the sense that we don't stick to what Baptists do from what others do. And we really look at the fullness of the faith journey. So has anyone ever had an experience with Catholicism in life in this particular organization? Anybody? Okay, so we have some members whom were early Catholics. As a matter of fact, one of the funniest things that happened on this past Sunday is that you may have seen two people who were in the back. Jen McGrath is one of them. She works at the Orpheum. And I forget the gentleman's name, I think it was Scott, who was with her, a Caucasian couple sitting in the rear. And they were like all over the church high-fiving people. And because I was talking about St. Peter, right, who in many cases, if you have an experience with Catholicism, is the person who the Catholics look to as the bedrock, if you will, of Catholicism. St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. Supposedly the remains of St. Peter are buried beneath that particular place. He was the first bishop of in the Roman Catholic Church and all of that. So when we were talking about Peter, and I used the word decommissioned and recommissioned, well, if you are a Catholic, when you are excommunicated, right, that means you've been cut off, right? You got to work hard to get put back in. And so he was back there, and he walked down to me after church. He said, man, I needed to hear everything you said. They just grabbed me and hugged me, and I was like, man, who are you? I was like, but I didn't know who he was until that moment. And we had a robust conversation. But it's the broadening of understanding and bringing all of those aspects in, I think, that sometimes that makes our faith journey all that it should be and complete in our lifetime. And so we have journeyed from Ash Wednesday, which is not a traditional thing that you would see in a Baptist congregation, but we embrace it as we look at our humanity, our mortality, and the journey of really being before Christ in a penitent kind of way as we walk toward Easter. We go from Ash Wednesday through the Lent period of the 40 days, identifying as Jesus identified in 40 days in the wilderness when he was tempted and weakened before the enemy and tempted of the enemy, but strengthened by God and the Spirit as he came out. We look at Palm Sunday, which has not been a traditional part of Baptist migration, but now I see more Baptist churches doing it and engaged in the Palm Sunday message, what that really means, what it's really all about. We talk about and expose people to Maundy Thursday, the Last Supper, which Jesus had with his disciples. Craig taught about Holy Week, all of the movements of Christ from Palm Sunday through Crucifixion Friday. And then we don't stop, however, at the resurrection. Most times, right after the resurrection, most times what you hear in the Baptist church is, get him up on Sunday morning, right? Got to get him up. And then we just kind of drop it right there. Well, there's really more to it. And the post-resurrection movements of Jesus are as essential to our faith as anything. I started with post-resurrection sermons on Sunday because everything the Lord's saying the same, and I continue to stay the path that the Lord has given me, that I preach over the next few weeks up to Pentecost will lead us through what Jesus did after the resurrection, all right? So there are how many days Jesus walked the earth after the resurrection? Anybody know? 40, right? He did something. So the 50th day is when Pentecost falls, right? The 50th day after the resurrection is Pentecost. He left 10 days before Pentecost on a day called Ascension, all right? And it was actually a Thursday, but it's celebrated on Sunday, Ascension Day, right? And we're going to see that. And this is on your calendar, by the way. If you Google it, you would find Ascension Day in most of your Apple calendars or Google calendars or different spaces, because many of the faiths around the globe embrace Ascension Day, when Christ ascends back unto his Father. And so this beautiful phrase comes out of it, and I just had a chance to enact a verse of it with Miss Marcy Fisher. She was standing there looking at a picture on the wall, and I walked by her and said, why do you stand there gazing? Right, that's what happened when Jesus ascended. An angel said to the people who were standing there, why stand ye there gazing, looking up into the heavens? The same Christ who goes up shall in some day likewise return. Because all of them were standing there looking up on that particular day. And so the fullness of the Eastertide experience is to really walk through all of that, right? And one of the most important things that happens in the transition or the movement, if I can say it this way, from Resurrection Day until Pentecost is the building and the birth of the church. All right, the building and the birth of the church. You don't have a church before Pentecost comes. But you do have the foretelling or the mentioning or the divulging of the concept of the church, because Jesus and which disciple have had a conversation? Who? Peter. Right. Jesus and Peter have had a conversation. And in Matthew chapter 16, it's in your outline, one of the most profound conversations. Remember this, Jesus gets into this conversation. Who do men say that I am? Right? Who do men say that I am? And so let's go to Matthew chapter 16, because that's really where the outline is going to pick up as we talk about this. And I want us to talk about building on the foundation or the starting or the building of the church as it moves from the resurrection up until the day of Pentecost, because this is essential to us. This is very important. Remember, the church up until Pentecost is nothing but a concept that has been discussed between Peter and Jesus and those who were around, right? It's kind of like saying, we're going to build a school one day. Well, until the bricks and the foundation are laid, we just don't have it. And if it's a physical school, and if it's the conception of a school, an educational space to train minds, that can take place when you order it and put it together. But there is no such thing as the church. All of this time when Jesus is moving about the earth, the disciples and the apostles and those who are moving with him, they are forming the foundation of what a church is going to look like. But there is no physical thing as a church until we get to this concept in Matthew chapter 16. All right, so let's go to Matthew chapter 16 first. And we're going to talk about four essential things found in Matthew chapter 16. All right, Matthew chapter 16. There is a conversation that takes place. How many people, are you there? Have you found it yet? All right, beginning where I want to start there in chapter 16, verse number 13. All right. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do men say that I am?" Pivotal question, right? Pivotal question. So he wants to know, what are people saying? What are people saying? Now, in any conversation, I'll always tell you this, when Jesus asks a question, he what? Already knows the answer, right? All right. Like most of you parents in here, when you ask a question, you really already know the answer, right? Setting your children up like that. But when Jesus asks a question, he already knows the answer. And what he's doing is he's trying to get the disciples to a point of maturity, because remember, this is the midpoint of the ministry when he's about to begin to divulge what is going to happen to him. All right. And if I'm going to divulge what is going to happen to me, what do I want to do? If I know, and Kiara, I'm using you as an example, and trust me, nothing's wrong. But if I know I'm leaving in a couple of weeks and something is going to happen that's going to change my daughter's life, what am I going to try to do before I leave? Prepare her. I'm going to try to get her as ready as I can. I'm going to try to build her up, strengthen her, get her to move from just the mechanicals of doing to being. Remember, at this point, the disciples, they've just been going with Jesus, right? Jesus been healing. Jesus been doing stuff. And they love it, right? But from this point on, when Jesus begins to talk to them about the founding of the church, he's going to be sending. He's going to be sending them. He's going to be saying, you do it. He's going to allow them. And then he's going to tell them how they're going to be empowered. He's teaching them some different things at this point. So watch Matthew chapter 16. Who do men say that I am? He gets into this conversation. Who do men say that I am? And Peter answers and says, some say John the Baptist. So they say, I'm sorry, it wasn't Peter. Some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? Right? What is that? That's a very intimate question, isn't it? What is it based on? What do you think that's based on? Who do you say that I am? Relationship, right? If the Lord asks any of us, who do you say that I am? I hope you can give an answer, right? And don't give an answer like this. You the war horse pawing in the valley. You the rose of Sharon. Those answers have already been used, right? Those are answers that you would be repeating that you've heard. But who do you say I am, right? I call him many things, right? In your experience, and I want you to get this, this is going to be a very important message coming up in the weeks to come. Everybody needs their own experience with Jesus. Everybody. Every individual in here, you can't live off my recognition of who Christ is. Right? That can strengthen you for a time of need, but who do you say I am? And that becomes pivotal. Now I want you to see something. Remember, I told you that Peter, good dude, man, had gone high and made some great professions of faith and had been that dude who had gotten a whole lot of things right. This is the guy who falls hard but gets back up. Thanks be unto God. We found that out on Sunday. But watch what Peter says. He says, you are the Christ, verse 16, the Son of the living God. Wow. That's growth, that's profession, that is faith, that is, this is the same guy who before the crucifixion says what? I don't know him, I don't know him, I don't know him. But he never did say he wasn't who he was. He said, you are the Christ. You are the Son of the living God. Jesus answers verse 17 and says, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, right? Bar meaning son of, right? For flesh and blood hath not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock, I will build my church. I want you to get this. God has given the foresight and the divulging of the church to who? To Peter. Peter is the one who makes the profession. The foresight is divulged of the church to Peter. Peter lays it out. And Jesus is the founder and the foundation of the church. Is not Peter, don't get that wrong, because a lot of people say, well, Peter's the foundation of the church. No, Peter's not the foundation of the church. Peter's profession is the foundation of the church. Upon this rock, upon this profession, upon this declaration that you have made, that I am the Son of the living God, that's the foundation of the church. So any church, whenever and when you're looking for a church, right, essentials, and I want everybody to get this and know it, whether you go, leave, whatever you do. If anyone professes anything other than Jesus Christ as the Son of God, it is not a church by which people are saved in the faith in which we believe. You got a lot of people who are out there professing Jesus lived. You got a lot of people professing Jesus was a good prophet. You got a lot of people say Jesus was a miracle worker. But they will not say that he is the Son of God. You get that? Get that? You can get into some of the great. I love Louis Farrakhan. I've been in the same space and program with Louis Farrakhan at an event, and I'm going to tell you something. Nobody knows the Bible as well as that dude right there, right? He knows the Holy Scripture. But can I tell you what he'll do? Stop very short of saying Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. Now, if you listen to him long enough and stand him up in a church, you'd think he was preaching in a Christian tradition. But he's not. But he does know the scriptures extremely well. So the confession of Peter is the foundation of the church. Get that? That's very important. The confession of Peter, upon this rock, I will build my church. Now, who is the founder when he says, I will build what? So who's the founder of the church? Jesus is, right? I will build my church. When you start getting, there's only one founder of the church, Jesus Christ, right? Jesus Christ, the only founder. Now, can I found a location I can establish? You can't found something that's already been founded, if I understand that right, right? You can't discover something that's already been discovered. Can I open another outpost? Yeah, right? I can establish another location. I can do all of that. But I can't be the founder of something that's already founded, right? That's like somebody discovering my house and saying it's theirs. Nice house. I found it. I'm the founder, right? You know, I'm going to go put my name on the title. Not without a fight, right? And so, by the way, they are doing that now. Check your deed every now and then, all right? So Jesus is the founder of the church. The foresight was given to Peter. The foundation is decided. The faith and defense of the church, I'm getting through these real quick so I can get into the lesson, is what? Jesus goes on to say the faith defense of the church is what? And the gates of what? Shall not prevail against it. Guys, come what may, and I tell people this all the time, listen, I have never, ever been worried about the church. I've never been worried about what's going to go on. You can move anything or anybody. And I've unfortunately run into some people who thought, well, they need me, or this ain't going to happen without me because I'm the only person who know how to do it. Moses opened the Red Sea, and the children of Israel kept going when they couldn't find it. Right? We still got a body of Christ, don't we? So never think for a moment that the church, anything can come against. God has a defense protection system around his church that he is always going to have righteousness available to continue his church now. His church. Now, again, everything that is open, I hate to tell you this, in the name of a church is not necessarily God's church. Right? Get that. So when you see things that no longer exist and say, what happened to that church? Maybe it wasn't God's establishment. Maybe it wasn't God sent in that sense, okay? And so Jesus is saying the faith defense of the church is simply this. Nothing is going to come against God's church and prevail. Did he say some things are not going to come against the church? He said the gates of hell shall not what? Prevail. Now remember this. Apply that to you because me and you are part of the church or the body of Christ. Actual words that we're going to see in Scripture in a moment, right? But if I am rightly situated in God's church as a part of what he has called for, then even when I feel pressed, it's not going to prevail. is not going to prevail against me. Prevail means to come forth with victory against an opposing force, right? Is it going to hurt? Yeah. Is it going to be confusing? Yeah. Is it going to be disappointing? Yeah. Is it going to prevail? No. It's not going to prevail. And so what Jesus is saying to Peter is that, Peter, based on the confession that you have made, I am the Son of God, the Son of the living God. This is the foundation of the church. I am the founder of the church. Here's the faith defense of the church, that the gates of hell should not prevail. Watch verse 19, and I'm moving on. And I will give you what? What do keys indicate in some just real simple ways? Access, authority, right? You would not, in a kingdom, give keys to just anybody, would you? Right, right? You would give keys to those whom had the authority. And so what Jesus does is delegates the freedom to the church to say, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Wow, the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Think about that. I have authority in heaven. You and I have authority in heaven. Watch what it says. When, all right, whatever you bind on earth will be what? What does that mean? What do you think that means? What does it mean to bind something? All right, whatever we choose to come against in our authority. You've heard this said before, if my people who are called by my name, right? It's the same authority given in the Old Testament when Solomon makes the confession of prayer. He gives much power to his people. Our ability to stand against things in a united way. Remember, the church is a called out group of people. You're going to see in a moment in the part of the outline. And so when you see that, when we're together as one, we become a very powerful group of people. Not just economically, by the way. We've seen the economic power of the church move. But what we need to see some days are the spiritual power of the church move. We need to see the spiritual force of people who stand and say, no, we just are not going to stand. And we're not going to come out and we don't have to march and fight and act, you know, whatever. All we got to do is pray and really be disciplined in the Lord. We do it in our households when we decide, hey, we're going to come together as one. We're going to fast and pray over something. We're going to resist the enemy. We're going to say our child cannot be taken. We're going to say that our neighborhoods cannot be overrun. We are going to come forth as the church. What he gives them the authority to do is to say, be united as one. Be together on one accord, as he tells them in the book of Acts, chapter 1. He says, be together in one spirit and watch the power of God come in. That's one of the things that the church has to remain on its agenda to access. And what happens to us is, I hate to say it, we get more divided than united. We want to be this location, that location, and not one location. We don't want to work together, right? You know, we keep trying to pull for this united effort in our communities. We've got to, I mean, because if people see us divided, what happens when people see anybody divided? What do kids do when they want to get some in their household, mom and daddy there? What do? Play one against the other, right? Churches get played the same way. Churches get played the same way. Government gets played the same way, right? Democrat, Republican, right? Black, white, right? Divide and conquer. But if we come together as one, we're forceful and powerful. And so what Jesus is doing is founding the church. But what happens right after he does this? Remember something, second part of your outline. Jesus' words, I will build my church, were foretelling of what was about to happen. But guess what? They got no power. There's no fuel in the engine. You got the framework, but you don't have the fuel at that point. The fuel of the church is what? The Holy Spirit, right? That's where the church is empowered. So Jesus has given them a framework. He said, I'm going to build my church, right? Up until the resurrection, there is no building of the church. There's no formal gathering of that which is going to be called the church. Jesus still has to undergo the cross and the experience of the resurrection. Go to John chapter 15, verse 26. John 15 and 26. And then we'll look at verses 16 and 13. He is saying to them in John 15, I was in Luke, so Luke and John are two different people. All right, John chapter 15, verse 26 and 27. Look at what he says. But when the Holy Ghost comes, when the Helper comes, whom I'll send you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who precedes me from the Father, he will testify of me, and you will also bear witness because you have been with me from the beginning. He's telling the disciples, right? This church that I have spoken to you about, or this mission that I'm speaking to you about, or this foregoing that I'm speaking to you about, is not complete until what? The power comes, the Helper. That's why he calls him the Helper in this verse, capital H, until the Helper comes. So many times, newsflash, God gives us mission and we don't wait for power. We get idea and we try to run without fuel, right? Whenever God gives you idea, he's also gonna give you power to fulfill the idea. But you have to wait on the Lord and be patient. Jesus is about to go through a period of time here where they go through a period of, oh man, they get in fear because of the crucifixion. They get nervous. All sorts of stuff happens. How hard is it to wait until God gives you the power to do or until you get an answer? Anybody in here ever had to wait on anything? 4 days, 10 days, 4 months, 5 months? How hard is waiting? Huh? Not easy, all right? I figured if it was hard, it's not easy. You gave the best answer. How difficult is waiting? I mean, I've been in training for 3 years, right? Remember, this is a 3-year journey most of the disciples are on. 3 years is tantamount to the time we spend in what area of our training? Master's degrees, right? Master's skills, right? I'm ready now, right? I'm ready to run the thing, right? Just tell me what to do and where to go. But Jesus tells them at the end of that time period to do what? Wait. 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 You remember the title of the message on Sunday was Grace. Wait for it, right? Wait for it. It's coming. You got to sometimes wait for it. How hard is it to wait for anything good? Anybody ever thrown in the towel right before it came and went and picked the towel up real quick like you didn't throw it and hit it behind your back and said, I just dropped it. I didn't mean to throw it in, right? Okay. Jesus is telling them about this great mission, and the next thing he says is wait. Couldn't you have just not told me about it? Why tell me about it and then tell me to wait? How many of us would have been better off not knowing? Come on. Right. That's probably. God starts to give you vision, and then he tells you to wait for power. It's not the first time. This is one of the times he's going to tell them to wait. He tells them in chapter 16, verse 13, John. However, whenever Jesus is talking about the Holy Spirit, he's capitalizing the words he and helper. Because the Holy Spirit is what? Person and not thing. It's not it. It's part of the triune part of the Godhead. So when we speak of the Holy Spirit, we speak of Holy Spirit as he, helper, capital H. Whatever the name that may be given is speaking of person and not thing or it, right? All right, so he says he in verse number 13. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak of his own authority, but whatsoever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. Why is Jesus telling him he's going to take of what is mine and declare it to you? Because Jesus is now saying to them what? I'm gone. John chapter 13, I go to do what? John chapter 14, 13 and 14, I go to prepare a place for you, right? I'm leaving, that where I am, there ye may be also. But I'm not going to leave you comfortless. I'm going to send you a helper so he will guide you into all truth. So you can't do this church work that I'm about to establish, Matthew chapter 16. You can't do this ministry work. You can't do this teaching, this preaching, this serving, this whatever your vocation. You can't do, you can't get them to put socks on until the power comes, right? You can't get into your mission field, your assignment, your life calling, your purpose, whatever you want to call it, until the power comes. And when you try to go without it, flop is on the way. Right? Confusion is on the way. Frustration is on the way. Discontent is on the way. Because you're going to be mad at God. Because God, you're going to say, God, you showed me that one day I was going to be doing this. I didn't show you today you was going to be doing it. And if you had waited for my authority, my power, you'd be a lot better off. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. So he's telling them right here, he still has to undergo the cross experience. The cross hadn't happened yet, right? All right, next part of the outline. I'm jumping you over. The book of Acts details the beginning of the church and its miraculous spread through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, Jesus talked about the Holy Spirit before the crucifixion, but they don't receive the power of the Holy Spirit until the day of Pentecost, the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit, right? So he speaks of that which is to come and says, you're going to be fine, right? After the resurrection, 50 days later, you're going to be fine. The power to do what I'm saying to you to do, to establish what I'm telling you to establish, it's going to come, right? But you got to wait for it. And so he tells them now in the book of Acts, as he details the beginning of the church and this miraculous spread of the power through the Holy Spirit, 10 days after he did what? Ascended, this is Ascension Day, back into heaven, the Holy Spirit was poured out on 120 of Jesus' followers who waited and prayed. And I say I don't always say 120, I'll say at least 120. Because if you read this verse clearly in Acts chapter 1, let's go to it as a matter of fact so you'll see it. Go to Acts chapter 1. I want you to see something there. I kind of took this as a, you know how you get into it with your seminary professors and you decide they're going to get the grade, they're going to give you the grade, so just go ahead and shut up and be quiet. I just wrote shut up and be quiet by this, but here's what it said. Verse 15, Acts chapter 1. And in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples. Altogether, the number of names was what? What does it say? It was about 120, right? So that's an approximation, right? And I said, well, it probably could have been 150. Just being smarty, you know, just being. But I, you know, because, all right, so I'm going to tell you what I was pushing, right? I was pushing inclusion because what the scriptures will say in the narrowest interpretation, and this is where I want you to get your broad world view, is it will say about 120, and then it goes on in these passages to say Jews, right? Jews. If we talk about Jews in the context of the scripture only without a broad world context, what we really leave out are brown-skinned Jews. Right? That's another lesson for another time. But, you know, Sammy Davis used to say he was a black Jew, right? But the truth of it is that there are black Jews. If Egypt and Mesopotamia and Africa and the concentric parts of the earth by which Eden is found and other spaces are as they are, you can't help but to have some dark-skinned Jews. And so in the King James Version of Scripture, if we're not careful, we will limit the day of Pentecost to being what we call the concentric circle of Jews. And if that's the concentric circle of Jews, that's where you get all of these narratives of, this is not a black folk religion, as if we weren't there. But the Bible goes on to say there were people from all over the space, right? And they heard their language on the day of Pentecost. And if they hear their language being spoken and are converted, and thousands of souls join the church, and they go back out from that place, they take religion and what is now going to be known as Christianity with them, right? And so you don't have this, we brought Christianity to you. We have, we are Christians, and we brought Christianity out with us, right? It's a different conversation. We can get into it in a whole lot of levels, but I went to a conservative seminary that wanted to be very conservative, and I pushed the envelope and said, you're going to include black folk in this conversation, right? And so I got good grades out of class. I didn't fail, I promise you. But the truth of it is that we are represented, right? We are represented, and I'll show you that when we get through reading. But as you continue to follow this particular outline, the Holy Spirit was poured out upon about 120 of Jesus' followers who waited and prayed in Acts chapter 1, verse 15, and then also in chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. Look at chapter 2, verses 1 through 4 with me. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the whole house that they were sitting, okay? Then there appeared to them divided tongues of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And so, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. There were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, all right, devout men from what? Every nation under the heavens, right? That's a key phrase right there. Every nation under the heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together. They were confused because everyone heard them speak in his own language. All right, so God is doing something here. And then if you go to verse 8, how is it that we hear in our own language in which we were born, Parthians and Medes and Elamites and those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya? Well, Libya and Cyrene, we already know that Simon of Cyrene is what? Simon of Cyrene is black, right? He is the black man who does what? Carries the cross for Jesus. So we know, and there's another dude in Romans chapter 15. His name is Rufus, right? You ever met a white guy named Rufus? No, I'm just kidding. All right. But truth of it is, I mean, come on. Simon of, you never have to have, all right? He really answered the question. I was just joking, it's rhetorical. But no, I never have either. So you have this beautiful mosaic, if you will, where God is doing his great work to establish churches. And so when we find these churches and we say, well, the oldest church is in Rome. No, man, oldest church can't be in Rome. If we got, maybe the oldest Catholic church is in Rome, but there are churches in Africa. There are churches in Libya. There are churches in Pamphylia, Asia Minor, filled with churches, right? That date back, and one of the things that we learned later and we were exposed to was how libraries were burned in Egypt to destroy the historical references to all of these things that predated some of the stuff that was published by others who wanted to say, well, we hold the founding document to who the church is and what it is. I want you to get this, and this is a sidebar somewhat from the lesson, but it's a part of it as well. If one church or one particular denomination or group can claim anything that is we are direct of Christ and superior, then they would like to dictate to others around the earth. This is where, and someone help me with my phrasing here so I can make sure I get it right. Hitler and his movement with the Aryan, is it Aryan nation, the superiority, blue eyes, blonde hair, white skin, all that kind of stuff. They were trying to assert their dominance in intellect and in every other area, right? That's why that that's why when that brother won that medal and hung and stuck his hand on him, they had to get him out of here right now, right? Because they were supposedly superior. And don't look too far to not know that that thought is not still permeating in society right now, right? I don't get into the political nature of this thing in our Bible study, but that Arianism and that thought of superiority and that Nordic and all of that kind of trend is still creeping in our society in ways that we have to be very careful of. And then when groups claim spiritual superiority, they claim moral and civic ownership, right? Like marriage, it has to be this way, right? And if you are divorced, then you are not of God's will. And those, because they will dictate these things. That's why in some churches and some places, you can be excommunicated and put out and never be brought back in because you got a divorce or something to that effect, or you sinned and you know, drank something you weren't supposed to drink, or did. And so we have a moral code that we can put you out, right? Because we claim exclusive authority and right. That didn't happen. In the book of Acts, it says to us very clearly, there were men from everywhere, all over the sun, right? And there were different practices in different nations that were represented there, and they took the word of God back and began to preach and teach in the nations in which they represented. And so when people try to give you this moral, where did it start? No, God dispersed his spirit. It said that those tongues sat up on what? Each head that was there. It was not me telling you or you telling me. It was God equally speaking, distributing, and we were in exchange, okay? And so get that and look at that very carefully. Some disciples who were afraid, watch what happens, are all of a sudden empowered. God empowered. You remember you last saw the disciples. What were they doing before the crucifixion? Hiding, right? Even in the book of Acts, what are they doing? They hiding. Where they at? In the upper room. Upper room ain't, listen, the upper room ain't, they ain't partying and hanging out in the upper room. They sitting in there saying, shh, be quiet, right? They scared, it's still a little tense out there, isn't it, right? And where they're persecuted for their faith and where they're being persecuted for what they believe and what is going on. Thousands of Jews from all over the world were in Jerusalem for the Feast of Pentecost. They heard the gospel in their own languages, chapter 2, verses 5 through 8, and many believed, and those that were saved were baptized, adding to the church daily. Let's go to the end of the chapter, chapter 2, verse 40. This is what I want you to see. This is after Peter's sermons. Chapter 2, verse 40. And with many other words, he testified and encouraged or exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship of breaking of bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking of bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness of heart and gladness and simplicity of heart. Watch the last verse. Praising God, having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the what? This is the founding of the church. You're not even going to see the word church anywhere else other than after you saw it when Jesus talks to Peter about it in the book of Matthew, and the next time you see it is in the book of Acts when Paul writes about it. Right over here. Right there. I'm sorry, when Luke writes about it. All right? Don't y'all let me say Paul when y'all know it was Luke, all right? All right. So that's where you get the book of, that's where you get that church. So the church has been empowered now, right? It's founded by Jesus, formed by Jesus. Peter has divulged it, and God revealing it to him. The foundation of it is here. And so now we see a church, an actual framework for what God has put in the earth. All right, a couple more slides, then I'm going to take a few questions, and I'm going to get you out of here, all right? The church began on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after the Passover. That's in chapter 2, verses 1 through 47, right? When you read that, I want you to get all of that because we're going to look at, we're gonna move right to that, right up to the day of Pentecost, right? So we're going to move right up to the day of Pentecost, looking at all of that. But look at what the word translated church comes from two Greek words that mean called out from the world for God. When you leave off the for God, right, you do still have what people might call a church, but it's just not for God, right? Y'all, there are a lot of distinctions between God's church and things that open in the name of churches. I want us to be very clear about that, right? There are a lot of things that we see, and I think this is a part of what we have to make sure we distinguish ourselves about. What is the foundation of the church really built around? Go back to Acts chapter 2, verses 40 through 47. They were, first of all, they had all things in common. They were sharing with one another. They prayed. They went from house to house. They had a unity, a common bond, right? They believed in Jesus Christ and the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because when I go over to the book of Ephesians and Colossians, I'm going to show you that in just a moment. These are essential foundations, right? If you don't get baptized, are you out of the church? Or do you have to be baptized to be in the church? Because they baptized all of those people. But let's talk about that. Do you have to be baptized to be in the church? Yolanda, do you have to be baptized to be in church? Mm-hmm. He believes you're not saved unless you're baptized, okay? All right. What do we believe about that? What do we think? Confess with your mouth, believe in your heart, and you shall be saved, right? All right. All right. Who gets saved? Who is the most famous saved and non-baptized person that you know? Thief on the cross, right? He's hanging out with Jesus, literally, right? And he says, remember me when you get to your kingdom. And Jesus says to him, go get baptized, and I'll take you home with me. And he said, how am I going to get down from up here to go get baptized? Jesus said, you figure that out. No. Water baptism is not essential to salvation. All right, let's know that, right? Because this is what makes us knowledgeable about our faith, right? So I got a cousin in the hospital, right? And all their life they've wrestled with, hypothetically, I don't have a cousin in the hospital, I'm just saying, they've wrestled with this God thing, right? They wrestle with it. But as they are lying there, they say, I believe God is real. And talk to you about it, right? And they say, when I get out of here, I'm going to come to church and I'm going to be baptized. Right? But hey, they don't make it. Or they get sick. They go home and have a setback and get sick. And they never make it to church. Is he not saved? Listen, folks, if God has such a litigious group, a litigious set of rules that I missed that one little step in my profession and confession, God is not as big as I thought he was. He's saying, I didn't get baptized. So we run into people like that all the time. I run into them all the time. I have people say, and literally, I had an 89-year-old couple right here from this community, philanthropic, good people, very nice, gave a lot of money to schools and different things, but they were Methodists. And they came to me and they said, Pastor Norman, we're getting close. They were older and frail. So we want you to baptize us. And I said, all right. And I sat down and talked to them. I said, you know, this is not essential to your salvation. Took them through the whole process. They were very devout Methodists, right? Knew the Methodist handbook, left to right, back to front. And at the end of all of the teaching, they said, yep, we know exactly what you're saying. But we too old to take any chances. Would you baptize us? And so to appease their desire, I will, but as long as they knew it wasn't essential to salvation, right? That was the part. And so all of those people in Acts chapter 2, verses 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, they were baptized. But folks, if you're not baptized, you're not going to miss heaven as long as you believe in Jesus Christ. And I want every person to know that, because I kind of think in our lifetime, all of us disciple some people at some point through our conversations with them who may not ever have been baptized, right? I think all of us come into contact with people, and we need to be able to know that, that water baptism is not essential to salvation. Yes. Very good. It's a very real thing. We have classes for both. We try to get people at the earliest age to help them to discern, to build their understanding and to know exactly what it is. We teach it right here Sunday after Sunday. And then periodically I have people who come back who'll be 30 and they'll say, hey man, I got baptized when I was very young. I want to do this thing over. Then I get, every now and then I just get some people come back and say, my baptism didn't take. It just did. I get those too, right? It's three groups. Those who will say it just didn't take, I said, let's just sit down and talk, right? Those who didn't understand and may have been a little confused about it, we walk them through the process, and then we allow them to make the decision, right? Because I want every soul to be comfortable as they work through their soul salvation and the process of going, all right? So that's good. But yes, and the people online have chimed in, only believe. And it is necessary that we believe in Christ. Baptism is a representation of dying in Christ and the resurrection. All very correct answers that they are putting forward. All right, let's go to the next one. The word church, I want you to get this. Where do we get this phrase body of Christ from? Body of Christ. Without going to the scriptures, what do you think? The body of Christ. Body of Christ is figurative for two things, all right? Craig is going to give us the first answer. If he get this wrong, I'm going to say, Craig, come on, man. The body of Christ. He says it every first Sunday, right? Where is that? What is the body of Christ, Craig? It's in our Holy Communion. The bread represents the what? Body of Christ, right? All right? This is my body, which has been broken for you, right? So when we speak of the body of Christ, two symbolic meanings. One is the figurative Holy Communion that we take in the breaking of bread. Can you take communion twice a Sunday? Can you take it twice on Monday? Can you take it every day, Monday through Friday? All right. All right, but it's another part too. Let a man so examine himself, right? So don't you be taking communion without examination, right? That's the other part. So yeah, you can do it every day, but that means examination every day, right? And at some point you're gonna examine yourself, I gotta check this out. Somebody's at the door right there. I think it's Logan, Brother Logan. So you can, right? And that is another ordinance of the church. There are two that we support, and that there are two in the Baptist church that Jesus left on record. Jesus said, as often as you do this, right? So he's saying, do it, right? It's an ordinance, and we uphold it in the church. Now, There's some things that we don't uphold in the Baptist church, right? Like, come sit in this little booth right here and talk to me while I sit here and listen to what you say. Go ahead, who want to be first? Confessional, right? Ain't nobody doing that. Confess your fault one to another, but confess your sins to the Lord, right? What's my fault? Tam, I don't do everything right. That's as much as I'm going to tell you. All right, I'm at fault, right? What's your fault about it? Listen now. You can't handle it if I tell you, right? Because it get on my nerve. I know it'll mess you up, right? So I'm going to talk about my sins unto the Lord. The word church, when used to reference all believers everywhere, is synonymous with the term body of Christ. Let's go to Ephesians, first chapter. I heard somebody say 2 Corinthians the other day, for real. And I was like, man, don't do that. All right. Ephesians chapter 1, let's go to verse 15. Are you there? Watch what he says. This is Paul writing. Therefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom. I want you to always remember that there is a spirit of wisdom. All right? Remember that there's a spirit of wisdom, okay? That the Lord may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Jesus Christ, or in Christ, when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places. Watch this, verse 21, 22, 23. Far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, in the one which is to come. He put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his what? His body, the fullness of him who fills all us in. So we're now the body of Christ. You see where we get that? So these words are not just stuff that people made up, right? Give an honor to God who the head of my life and the body of Christ and all that. This is the formation of us all united. Now, there are what I like to refer to when I get into another one of these great debates, when I get into Eric Winston and Kent Hall and we go on these trips and I really want to set it off real bad, I'll think of a question that I know is going to mess with everybody, right? And then I'll throw it out there and then I'll start reading the book like Socrates used to do, I mess with him. So I asked them one time, who all is going to get into heaven? Jesus says this wonderful thing in Scripture. Many sheep I have that are not of this fold, but I must bring them also to my Father. And so Eric will lean back and say, well, what you saying, Norm? I'll say, that's what I'm asking you. And then we get into these great debates, because for years, what we've tried to make Christianity is the exclusive access to God. Jesus is access to God exclusively, but that doesn't mean Christianity is access to God exclusively. If I am a professing whatever who, what did I do? Confess that Jesus is what? Lord, right? My confession of Christ and my belief in Christ that he is the Son of God is what gets me access and entrance to God. My practice of faith can be confused and I can be over here somewhere, but I still believe in Jesus. Don't you let a person's outward actions fool you about their inward heart and confession. Many sheep I have that are not of this fold, them I must bring also unto my Father. We're going to have to reconcile a whole lot of things that we've tried to push people away and keep them out from God, right? There are going to be people that we say that didn't act right, right? This man was out there shooting and killing folk and doing all this stuff. He said Jesus was Lord, and he believed in God. But God gonna let him in heaven too? Many sheep I have that are not of this fold, them I must bring with me also. I believe we're gonna get to heaven, there's gonna be some folk we looking for, we're gonna say, where they at? You know, millions didn't make it, but I was one of the ones that did. And then I believe there are gonna be people that we don't expect to be in heaven that are gonna be there. So that's why Jesus said, let the wheat and the tares grow together. My Father separate, right? And so we don't get into those things. So we make up the body of Christ by our faith in what Jesus says. And look at it in this passage again. He puts it in here that he made it clear that God raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in heavenly places. Essential to our being a part of the body of Christ is the way we approach Jesus Christ and believe in him and accept him as the Son of the Father. And that's how God brings us into his fold. All right, last one, Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. Colossians chapter 1, verse 18, and we're timed right on, all right? And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he may have preeminence. That's it. Jesus Christ, head of the church, founder of the church. Peter makes the great proclamation, and Jesus says, upon this proclamation, upon this rock, upon your profession, I'll build my church. Gates of hell shall not prevail. That's the defense of the church, is our faith in God. All right? The freedom of the church is that we have authority here on earth. When we act in accord to God's will, you bind it on earth, he binds it in heaven. You loose it on earth, he looses it in heaven. He gives us that authority when he brings us together and forms us into his body, into his body. The power is not in the individual. The power is not in the one. If you are noticing anything in Scripture, whenever you see something playing out, truth is bared out between two or three witnesses, being on one accord is in all of us being strengthened together. He tells us that when my people are called by my name, rarely do you see a one investment or a one-off investment of power in Scripture. Rarely do you see it. God is always creating us that we might live interdependent upon one another. It's not good that man should live alone. All of these things are part of what he says so that we would find our power in being connected to one another and through him. So as we look at this, what I want to do is continue to walk towards it now. Next week, several of the things we're going to do as we continue to look at the pathway to Pentecost is what I'm going to kind of look at. I've put together a couple of other timelines that I want you to see some things that are taking place. In particular, by the time we get to Ascension Day, there are about seven things I want to look at. One of them is the election of another disciple. Anybody remember who that dude was? Yes. Matthias, right. Do you know why they elect him? Judas goes out, but it wasn't solely because Judas goes out, right? All right, it could have been the number. If I tell you now, it won't be a Bible study then, though, will it? Won't give you anything to look at in the research and then to come back. I want you to look at that. That is critical to fulfillment of things that had to happen. It's critical. Because I want you to remember something. If any prophetic word about the crucifixion and the resurrection and Christ is not fulfilled, then he is not Christ. And there's some very unique things in Scripture that when you read them, right, you just kind of read past them, right, and you say, why will we elect a guy that we never hear from again? Because you ain't never seen the book of Matthias. What church did Matthias plant? Where did he go? What did he do? Right? You never hear from him. And it's not about the future. It is about the past. All right? So let's look into that and look at all of those things as we come back. All right. Any questions before I wrap on tonight? All right. In weeks to come, I had mentioned, and we're going to talk about this, you'll be able to, if you want to, if you had your headphones on and you were tuned in to YouTube or to where else will we tune into, the broad app, when Bible study is being talked through over here, you could be outside walking in the park because it'll be open and you'll be able to say, okay, I'm listening to Bible study while I walk, right? It'll be a good connection. We're just opening it up as another opportunity. All right. Since there are no questions, were there no questions at all? Were there any announcements that I was supposed to share, staff and team? Okay. Anything, Craig? All right, good. All right. That's it. All right, so let's get in our small circles before we leave. Let's stand and get in our small circles real quick. Prayer emphasis for tonight is one simple thing. What is it that I need in a church? What is it that I need in a church? What is it that I need in a church? Online, what is it that I need in a church? As you hear what I need in the church, what can I give in my church? What can I be to my church? What can I be in my church? What can I be for my church? You can continue conversations, but here's our prayer as we conclude for tonight. Lord, help me to receive what I need from your church by giving what you've given me to give to your church. Show us, dear Lord, how to be there for one another, not just as recipients, but as givers. God, when the weeks to come, we will speak of the gifts to the church that you empowered each believer to possess. Teach us to use them in your kingdom building work. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
Hey there.
How you doing?